in regard to my book, Prabhupada's Kirtan Standards. Seems necessary because the standards over time get lost. But at the same time, we don't want to be all rules and regulations. There's a kind of a tension between rules and regulations and then the spirit of the thing. So the main thing is the spirit of the thing, the devotion and love that the devotees want to express. And then there are various rules. But I've mentioned in all of my kirtan seminars that all of my favorite kirtan leaders and devotees I most admire and look up to, they all break one or another of the rules all the time. I'm reminded of a story I read, or a little anecdote, that in my parents' time, the big singer was Frank Sinatra. Still, I think his name is known, but that's about it. But the name at least is still there. He was quite the thing. And he was doing some recording somewhere in the studio, and there were various people there. Apart from the engineers, there were various others. And one of the people present suggested that Sinatra could rephrase a line, you know, not rewrite it, but sing it in a different way. And another person who was present said, listen, you don't tell Frank Sinatra how to sing. He's Frank Sinatra. So I keep that in mind because it's not for me to sit in on the computer someplace and tell the devotees who are dedicated to kirtan how they should mind their P's and Q's, as they say, because they're they're showing the main thing, enthusiasm and dedication to chanting the holy name, spreading the holy name, and that's the essence of the thing. So if my book results in a whole lot of people who go around, you know, with magnifying glasses and fingers waving, then that's not the result that we want to achieve either. But still, there's some guidelines about kirtans, and sometimes, you know, we get far out, and then a little farther out, and pretty soon we don't see the shoreline anymore. So, I hope the book will be useful in, you know, reminding us or informing us of various principles and standards that Prabhupada gave us in every department, in the deity worship, in the cooking, in the glass giving, everything we do. There's some instructions for us to follow. And that will help us. And of course, the great enemy is the tendency to concoct. Prabhupada observed that the tendency to, it's almost like an itch. You know, you all have to invent something new. Prabhupada quoted a humorous song by a Bengali poet. D.L. Roy, who said, just do something new. Get your nitto nakoro. Walk on your hands or something new, something different. Just don't do the same thing. Well, that tendency is there. First, want to do something new, something different, something unique. But the challenge is how to keep what we've gotten intact. Evam parampara praptam, imam raja shirabhi. It's handed down. And our job is to basically to keep it as it is, Bhagavad Gita, as it is. So the philosophy and everything, how to keep it as it is, and at the same time make it expert, make it tasteful, make it attractive, but not at the cost of the thing itself. Not the cost of the thing itself. And that requires some guidance, some judgment, how to keep the thing as it is and at the same time present it effectively, attractively. Prabhupada sometimes said, old wine, new bottle. The bottle may change, but the wine should stay the same. Otherwise, sakale nehamata yoganashta parantapa. Over time, someone changes, someone has another change, and then everything gets lost. Over time, sakale nehamata. Over time, yoganashta. Everything becomes forgotten, lost, misplaced, changed. So, Prabhupada mostly emphasized to us keeping it as it is, especially seeing how eager, he said, especially you Americans, this is your disease, you always want to change. Even if GBC men say you make something and you want to break it, this should be broken. And then now again, make something new, break it, make it. So, no, keep it as it is. That's our, what's given to us, we have to transmit without change, without adding anything, without subtracting anything, without concocting or inventing anything. That's what Prabhupada did. And at the same time, he made it, he did what he needed to do to make it accessible, to make it relevant, to make it practical for different places, different times. So we have something wonderful. And we just have to be careful to treat it very carefully so that it remains potent, it remains authentic, it remains substantial. Then people will appreciate it. It's not, I was just reading, I'm doing the index for the book, so I'm reminded of what's in it now. And there's one history, there was a road show back in the 1970s, headed by Vishnu John Swami and Tamokrishna Goswami. Tamokrishna was sometimes there. He came toward the end. But Vishnu John Swami was there. Others were there. Sudama Maharaj. And at first Prabhupada encouraged it. They were traveling with the bus and they were doing the whole presentation, festival. And they had a rock opera and electric guitars and so on. And for a while, Prabhupada encouraged it, but then he shut it down. He said, another change, every day another change. Stop all this nonsense, just chant Hare Krishna. And he said that it's not these external things that will attract people, but it's the purity of the devotees, which comes from following strictly regulative principles, chanting Hare Krishna, and from speaking Bhagavad Gita with his Srimad Bhagavatam. He said that's what will attract the conditioned souls. All they name, the message of Bhagavad Gita, it is Srimad Bhagavatam, not all these tricks and gimmicks. He didn't use the word gimmick, but that was... He sent a letter to all the temple presidents in GBC at this point, had Rander and Shamsundar write a letter, which he endorsed. But we should just chant Hare Krishna and present Bhagavad Gita and Srimad Bhagavatam. That will be effective. So in our lives and in our attempts to, in everything that we do, we should stick to our principles. We should know what our principles are, and then we should stick to them. And at the same time, have the flexibility to adjust as much as needed, but not so that we water things down or turn things around to make it what we think people would like. If we keep it as it is, those who are serious, we'll take what Prabhupada said about those who are attracted to the rock opera. He said they'll come and then they'll go. They're attracted superficially and they'll leave. You won't get substantial people that way. But if we present our message as it is, and those who are looking for substance will find substance. And the message is the substance is something that you want to stick to. All right, that's maybe enough for the moment. And should I take some questions? We'll take some questions. Okay.
Maharaj, how do we know in personal life where that line is between new and innovative and still preserving? New wine in an old bottle, because we see some devotees like Bhakti Tirtha Swami, the things he did. Like Bhakti Tirtha Swami, he did the things he did, the innovative things he did. So how do we know the limits where it's innovative but still preserving the message, and where we are crossing the line and watering things down?
First of all, we need purified consciousness, or we won't know anything. That comes from following the regular principles strictly, four regular principles, chanting 16 rounds a day, getting up early in the morning, doing all the things that we're meant to do. Otherwise, our faculties of perception will be defective or impaired. My godbrother, Rabindra Srup Prabhu, makes this point that we usually think of the four regular principles as moral principles. They're moral principles that we have to follow. But he says they're cognitive principles. By following these four rules, our cognitive faculties are purified so that we can function properly. We can know what is what. Otherwise, our cognitive abilities would be, they'll have cognitive impairment. We won't be able to know what is what. and then where the line is between this and that, we won't be able to tell. And that's the first thing. Second thing is we should be familiar with Prabhupada's instructions, with the books, with the tradition, with what Krishna consciousness is. And we should make a distinction between where we draw the line with ourselves and where we draw the line for others. For ourselves, I suggest that if we're unsure where the line should be drawn, then the expression is discretion is the better part of valor. They're better to err on the side of
caution,
on the side of sticking to our principles. If you make that error, it won't be terrible. But if we start inventing and concocting, thinking, well, then one thing leads to another, and pretty soon we're out in the middle of the lake somewhere. But for others, we should be a little slow to judge, to criticize, to sit as evaluators of who's off and who's on. We can appreciate that they're trying to do something, and sometimes we'll appreciate that it's not very orthodox, but the results are wonderful. So we should be a little slow to criticize, because it's the same principle, really, to err on the side of caution. With ourselves, that means being a little conservative. And with others, it means being slow to criticize. Because if we've learned anything, this we should have learned, that to criticize Vaishnavas is potentially is toxic. So we don't want to become expose ourselves to internal toxin by developing a mindset critical of the Vaishnavas. Is that okay?
Yes.
And still, it doesn't mean that we're totally indiscriminate, that we can't see that when something is really wacko. But we should be slow to criticize.
Maharaj, can you tell us the history of the "as it is" phrase? When did Prabhupada come up with that himself, or?
It was the subtitle for Prabhupada's edition of Bhagavad Gita. If you look at the manuscript and you see how he advertised it in his old Back to Godhead in India, the title was Gita Upanishad. Sarva Upanishado Gavo Dutta Gopala Nanda. The essence of all the Upanishads. The essence of all the Upanishads is Bhagavad Gita. So Prabhupada titled it Gita Upanishad. And then he had a subtitle, Bhagavad Gita, as it is. And at some point, I don't really know when, because it was before I came, but Bhagavad Gita, as it is, became the title, and Gita Upanishad was set aside. I don't really know the history, whether the editors thought that Gita Upanishad would fly, or what the reason was, but Bhagavad Gita, as it is, became the title. And then in 1983, when we published the second edition, those who know Devanagari will recognize that we put a sort of a decorative Sanskrit word there on the title page. And the word is Gita Upanishad. Mm-hmm. So in that way, we got the title back in. There was no question of changing it. That, you know, once it was Gita, the Bhagavad Gita as it is, for Prabhupada's whole career, there was no changing it. But we, that was the way we got Gita Upanishad back in. And of course, Prabhupada really ran with that phrase. He made clear that that was the distinction of this Bhagavad Gita and this Krishna consciousness movement, is that its purpose was to present Krishna's message as it is, whereas there were so many editions where the purpose was to present something else, the opinion of the translator, the commentator. So as it is. And that's again the same message, you know, to keep it as it is.
Maharaj, sometimes we might criticize others, at least in our head, because they're not following certain standards as a result of being frustrated with ourselves for not following those same standards. I wonder if you've got any thoughts on that.
That we criticize others for not following the same standards that we're also not following?
Yeah.
That tendency is there to want to be great, to want to inflate our own value in the way they inflate currency. We want to inflate our own value. And so we do it by essentially two strategies. I'm not quoting Shastra here, but from, I think it's safe to say, one is that we advertise our own glories, and the other is that we tear down everyone else. Because if I'm glorious, then I rise, and if others are lousy, then my relative status again is heightened. So these are the two ways that we can be great. We can advertise our own glories and criticize everyone else. And that's called the material world. And the atheists and the Mayavadis, they're in the same game. What is that? Abhijananti mabhuta manushim tamvashri. They badmouth Krishna for having a human form, and they go on from there about his whatever they want to criticize. So it comes from envy, of course. I want to be great, but there are all these other competitors who also are potential contenders for whatever post of greatness I hope to occupy. So that becomes the material world, we're all envious of one another. And Prabhupada said the envy starts from envy of Krishna. It's Jayadvaita Swami. Material existence is a result of our own desires to enjoy and our own envy, dvesha, our own antipathy toward others. It's jadvesha samutena. So we really need to watch out. Better is to appreciate and especially to appreciate the Vaishnavas. If we want to criticize, it seems that our predecessors have given us some scope for criticizing the materialists, the impersonalists, so many kinds of those who are against Krishna in one way or another. Yes. But the Vaishnavas we should appreciate. Not think that the Vaishnavas are ordinary persons subject to our own, mundane, evaluative capabilities. We'll miss it. Even the most supposedly insignificant Vaishnavas, we don't know what they're doing to Krishna or how much Krishna appreciates their service. When we criticize, find out the fault, we're harming ourselves. Our Parshad Prabhu, some of you may know it, he speaks of the who the hell are you mentality. And we wander around and whoever we meet, it's like, well, who the hell are you? And nobody else really matters. Who the hell are you? So we shouldn't think that way about the Vaishnavas. Who the hell is he anyway? He's only this, he's only that. Prabhupada said the person who's cleaning the temple room is as important as the person who's editing back to Godhead. So, wasn't aimed at me because I wasn't the editor. But the idea is there. Ye bhaje shevana bhaktinja. All the Vaishnavas are great. Only the abhakta, they're wretched.
Thank you.
Hare Krishna Maharaj. Just building on that, which one is worse, who the hell are you, or don't you know who I am?
If one is there, the other will also be there.
My question was the purity of a holy person.
Louder.
The purity of a holy person. How does that work in a Santa Rasa kind of situation?
In a Santa Rasa.
So where just. By that I mean just the presence, right?
Just
the presence of a pure holy person. How does that work on jivas?
I don't understand how Shantaras comes into play here.
By that I mean by just simple presence of a
That's pure. Not Shantaras.
No.
Presence just means presence. Okay. Shantaras is a particular situation in relationship to Krishna, the relationship of neutrality is just appreciation. It's not quite active service. No, that's Shantaras. Some of the acharyas don't even count it as a ras, but we generally acknowledge it, but we don't give it much importance. So Shantaras. Sometimes it's said that the saintly persons who are a little above the Brahman platform, they have some attraction to Krishna. then maybe it's Shantaras. And we have a tend, we tend sometimes, we use these terms and we put them into, you know, a more general context and it gets lost. So editors don't like that. Now, your question.
I think you've answered. I'm just sort of saying that, you know, the is there another medium by which the jivas are affected by the presence of a pure devotee?
I was just hearing some discussion about that. The main thing is by their instructions. Otherwise, just sitting in the same room with a pure devotee, even that is good. And just by that presence, we may get some benefit. But the real thing is, we don't read in Srimad Bhagavatam about devotees just sort of being present. When Vidura approached Maitreya, it wasn't, well, what do you want? I just want to be in your presence. No. There's some inquisitiveness, there's some tattva to be inquired about, some truth to be sought. And that, what is that? Karnarandrina. You know that verse? Sarodulam Pravishta Karnarandrina. Try that. Yeah, close. I think it's Pravishta Karnarandrina. Something like Sarod. The idea is that the message of the pure devotee enters the ear and purifies the heart. That's what we hear again and again. It's not just that we, you know, bask in the atmosphere of purity created by the devotee, but we take the opportunity to hear his message. To ask questions, relevant questions, to hear and to render service. Therefore, Krishna gives that direction. Tam viti pranipatena paripashne. Save it. Krishna could have said, you just find a pure devotee and be there. Okay, if that verse comes at some point.
Is it this one?
Got it. Okay. Kavishta karna mandrina swanam pava surodhuram tunoti shamalam krishna shalila sya yatasharat. The sound incarnation of Lord Krishna, the Supreme Soul, that is, Srimad Bhagavatam, enters into the heart of a self-realized devotee, sits on the lotus flower of his loving relationship, and thus cleanses the dust of material association, such as lust, anger, and hankering. Thus it acts like autumnal rains on muddy pools of muddy water. So it's that hearing, Karnarandrina, comes through the ear.
Thank you so much. When we're talking about criticizing devotees, there's one where you criticize someone and it's not true about them, it has an effect on you. But if you're criticizing a devotee and they have done wrong and it affects the mission, and how do you approach that? Do you approach that to the devotee or to the authority? How would that work?
That also one has to consider very carefully. You know, it affects the mission. What does that mean?
get all. Henny Penny, I think, is what in America it's Chicken Little. I think in this country it's Henny Penny, am I right? The sky is falling. You know, there's, it's going to affect the whole movement. Whatever it is, everything's going to be, the sky is going to fall because this person, you know, ate beans on a codicil or something. For those who are interested, some time back I came across quite a witty and insightful little telling or retelling of the Henny Penny story in a manner relevant to modern technology and social media. So it's posted on my website. I forget under what title, maybe somebody else. But it's quite good and relevant to us. So we should be, again, a little slow to ascribe the catastrophic effects to, you know, to start talking about the catastrophic effects that will happen if we don't do something about whatever the wrong is that's been said or done by a Vaishnava. Because that can set into effect a whole set of other wrongs in which, you know, whatever it was that person did is nothing compared to the wrong that we do by starting another wave of sadhu-ninda, which is really easy to do on the internet. So we should be very careful. Even the materialists know that, not about sadhu-ninda, but in the very early days of the internet, I don't want to talk about it. Anyway, the idea is be careful about letting your fingers do the walking. But then there are things that are serious, and it's not just that we want to say, well, you know, I don't want to offend a devotee, so I can't say anything. But the first thing is we should not be ill-motivated, not that we want to drag someone down. There's a story, I heard it secondhand, but I heard it secondhand from a pretty good source, as having come from Prabhupada, that there were some, in Gaudiya Math, someone was doing something, maybe taking money or whatever. And I don't remember what the criticism was. And they brought it to Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur. And he chastised them. That you're just concerned about this loss of money, but you don't care about the person. You're just concerned about the loss of money and you don't care about the person. So that's the first thing, that we shouldn't be wishing ill to anyone who's chanting Hare Krishna or trying to serve Krishna. So we should be reluctant. If we have to do something, we have to do something, but not that this is where we get our jollies, this is where we get our pleasure from finding, I knew it was there. Finding the fault in the Vaishnavas. Then if there is something, best thing is if we can bring it up to the person, if, according to our relationship also. With our peers, we may bring these things up. But, you know, Shamananda, I noticed that, you know, this or that, and, you know, don't mind, but you might want to think about this. Or in some other way, have some appropriate means to bring it up. With our seniors, it's different. Then the recommendation is that we bring it to some other senior person, that this is the situation, and what do you want to do? Can you say something? Whatever. Not jump into confronting our seniors immediately. Generally, the advice is, even when there's disagreements among seniors, I'm paraphrasing, but it's keep your head down, let them work it out. And again, this doesn't mean that where there's serious harm that's being inflicted or risk that is being introduced, we just shine it all on. It's because we don't want to commit Vaishnava Aparadhas, but we should be very careful and cultured. And Prabhupada makes this point. Krishna consciousness is not just a philosophy, but it's a culture. And it's a culture of Krishna consciousness. So a cultured person knows how to treat these things. And we suffer sometimes from not having the cultural background, and therefore not knowing how to appropriately bring these things up. Because one thing is, what's right and what's wrong, and what's needed and what's, what has to be done, which may legitimately be there. But the other side of it is, how does a cultured person deal with such things? And too often, we not having a background of Vaishnav culture, spiritual culture, we drag in our materialistic culture with its crudeness and its sort of arbitrary and clumsy way of dealing with things. And that can create other kinds of bad feelings, among other things, but also can really get in the way of spreading Krishna consciousness and cultivating Krishna consciousness. So we want to be, to learn how to be cultured devotees, how to learn Vaishnava culture. Therefore, Bhakti Charmaj gave a course, Vaishnava Etiquette. And some of the basics of just how a cultured person should behave. And when you get to really, when we get in the company of really cultured people, then we get the example of how they deal with these things. Not with just mere crudeness, but with discretion.
Hey Krishna Maharaj, I've got just following on following the rules. I have always done my japa silently, and I've always done it since the age of about 17 years old, so it's a long, long time. It's been brought to my attention that I should really be doing it loudly. I have tried and I just cannot sustain it.
I was just listening again, Hari Parshad Prabhu, who's a very learned person. He's been giving a series of in-depth classes on Vaishnavata. And then the one I've been listening to most recently, he's brought up from Shastra, that there are three kinds of japa. And one is manasik, silent. And the other is more like what we usually find in ISKCON, sort of mixed with some element of kirtan, it's loud. And then there's in the middle, there's a sort of quiet japa where you hear yourself, but others won't really hear you. Yeah, maybe they hear a word or two, but you know, usually we, Hare Krishna, Krishna, you know, that comes in the third category. It's loud. And then there's totally silent, which is difficult, very difficult. That comes more on the meditation side. On the one side you have the out loud where it has some element of kirtan in it practically. And you hear it, everyone else hears it, but we're hearing it. And then on the other side, it's all in the mind. That tends more toward what the yogis do, you know, deep meditation, which is hard for most of us in this age, because our minds will wander. For those who are advanced, it's, you know, they can do it. They can actually have the name, form, qualities, pastimes of Krishna right there in their minds. Even when we're chanting out loud, our minds are elsewhere. Srila Prabhupada recommended that we should chant in such a way that we can hear ourselves chant. And I was just reading a purport, he said, you should chant and don't chant loudly. He even went that far. And other times he said, you know, loud enough so that you can hear yourself chant. If you wish, you can move a little bit to one side. The quiet chanting is, it's what I'm doing these days, just out of force. you know, I can't chant Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna. You can hear yourself, but no one else really hears you.
But I don't even gesticulate with my lips either. It's silent.
You're totally silent. Well, that's not our standard. It's not what Prabhupada taught us. But I'm not going to tell you, you know, what to do or what not to do. You didn't even ask me a question, I think. You just told me that would
disappear. it's in the context of following the rules. I know that it's not actually one of the four regulatory principles.
No.
But everybody does it, but I don't.
Yeah. It comes under 16 rounds, I guess. The Kadamba Kanana Marsh in his last days, that's what he was doing. Because he couldn't chant out loud. In the very last days. And I saw that I saw he was really doing it because he was chanting on his beats. Sometimes they go like this. Sometimes it would be, you know, slow. And I realized that it was, every bead was a mantra. It wasn't just that he was pulling the beads. But when he's, you know, when we reach the end of one mantra and the beginning of the next, then the bead would go. But it was in his mind because he didn't have the strength to train. And he said, remind them. So if that stage comes, you'll be very well prepared.
Maybe that's what I'm preparing for.
Guru Maharaj, I just wanted to give you an example. In Ivory Coast, there was a devotee who is chanting early morning with us, and I realize when he is chanting, he is fast, and virtually half of the mantra is chanted. Hare Krishna Krishna Ram Ram Ram. Hare Krishna Krishna Ram Ram Ram. So because I could hear him, I realized things are not going right. First thing I did is I recorded, and then after Jap, I sat down and explained to him the whole thing. So sometimes it helps, somebody can correct it. If we go wrong in the association of the devotees are very helpful. They can support other devotees to chant in a correct way, whatever. So he was very grateful. Actually, he took initiation last month. So that was good.
But,
yeah, actually japa is, in one sense, it's personal meditation. And you can say from that point of view, we should just chant by ourselves. But then, we did in Prabhupada's presence chant together. And then there's one benefit that others take. You know, be able to. I was sitting in Vrindavan this past Kartik, at Krishnabharam temple. There was a chanting. And there was a devotee in front of me. It seemed to me he might have been from Delhi, business person or something like that. And he's chanting Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna. And you know, it was like not once, not twice, but you know, whole rounds were going by this way. And I was getting distracted. So I got up and sat next to him. So sometimes being with others can help.
Maharaj, in 2007 in Leicester, Pujumana Prabhu organized a retreat where yourself, Kadamba Kanana Swami, and Jay Pataka Swami were present. And there were these workshops on rotations where the groups had to move around. And Jay Pataka Swami, he got people to chant one round. They're seated in a circle. And then he had this really big like poster like rolled up to make a kind of a, what's it called? Like a
telescope
type of thing, you know. So he would go around and listen to devotees chanting their japa. And in my group, I was chanting really slowly because I was scared, you know. But in my group, I had two Prabhupada disciples, and he was going around listening to everyone, chanting a couple of mantras, and then he'd give feedback. And it was quite surprising that he was saying a lot of you are saying too many words or missing words. And just to reiterate the point, like, it's helpful being with other people because we think we got it down, and we're going down. It's not worth it.
They're trying to say we shouldn't chant too fast or too slow, too loud or too soft. They don't say just what too fast or too slow is. They don't give up. You know, give it to us in seconds. But Prabhupada said that we should be able to hear ourselves chanting. We should chant clearly and distinctly. And I have no affection for japa tapes, by the way. That was not something Prabhupada gave us. It was introduced at some point when someone recorded Prabhupada chanting, and then it became, you know, now we can chant with Prabhupada. play the drum. And the Hari Parsha was saying, well, why don't you just put on the tape and listen? You don't even have to chant. You can listen to the sound vibration of the pure devotee and you don't have to do any work. But I was very happy to hear from Yadubara Prabhu that one of our god sisters had said, I think she was in Texas at the time, and when this tape first came out, she said to Srila Prabhupada, oh, it's so nice, Srila Prabhupada, now we can, while we're chanting japa, we can listen to your tape. And Prabhupada said, that's not very good. He said, you should hear yourself chant. How about that?
Any other questions? Otherwise,
one very quick question.
Sorry
about that.
Let her ask because you'll
carry on.
Yeah, please.
Oh, on the note of chanting, I joined a group full of strangers chanting in the morning early. And one Mataji, I had just not long been initiated, and she openly said in the group about my chanting that I was not repeating Hari Hari at one point. And really in a way that you should know better, you know, that was, and kind of really made me feel small in a way. But in a way, it really turned out to be the best thing that's happened. Because we became friends, she apologized. It was months later. She saw me in the temple and she apologized. And I said, how? I couldn't remember that. I said, because I really, you know, forgive her. And I didn't forget, but I forgive. she was smiling and waving, and I couldn't recognize her. But later on, she came over and said, she's ever so sorry. I said, how did it come to life that you felt this way differently? And she said that her husband told her that it was very wrong and that nasty things to do. And I wanted to say at the time, you should have gone back to the group and apologized to the group, really. But anyway, I forgive her and we became friends. So isn't that wonderful? She's really a close friend now.
Chant Hare Krishna and make friends.
Well, so then we'll finish.
Yeah, it's just a quick question. We have two kind of devotees who chant the Panchatapa Mantra in between rounds, and some of them in the beginning. I mean, the recommended one is to chant once in the beginning and carry on chanting. I know I had a conditioning in the past. I always chant the Panchatapa Mantra in between. So is that really inappropriate? Can we avoid doing that, or it's not necessary to do that? I mean,
yeah,
we'll also have a conditioning to always chant the Panchatapa Mantra.
This came up in my Kirtan seminar in Mayapur. I found out from a show of hands that about half the devotees of the room had been taught that after each round or before each round, you should chant the Panchatattva mantra. Some were told you should chant on the head bead,
yeah,
and so on. None of this came from Prabhupada.
Mm-hmm.
None of it came from Prabhupada.
Maybe we should raise hands.
Yeah.
Yeah, who was taught that you should chant?
I was told that.
You're about average,
we're
kind of
all
half
all
the room.
I was on a
walk with you, Maharaj, and then I finished one round and I said, Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya, and you said, what are you doing? And I was like, I'm awake. And you told me the story.
Now that said, you can chant the Panchatattva mantra at any time, there's no restriction. But there's no rule that you have to chant Panchatattva mantra, and if you don't, and this will be one of the revelations among the many in my Kirtan Standards book. It's one of those things that gets started and pretty soon everybody thinks that this is what Prabhupada said. There's a famous Prabhupada said that so many times I hear Prabhupada said, and I have not said. There's another story that Lakshmi Murthy tells that there was some, Prabhupada was instructing her about something regarding to deity worship, and she said, but Prabhupada said, he said, I am Prabhupada. And so many initiations I was present, Prabhupada instructed, so you start here, the head bead, and you go to there, and then you go back. There's no Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya. And the quotation that I've given here, Prabhupada said, that is for kirtan, and this is japa. The instruction is there in Chaitanya Charitamrita before kirtan. Yes, Pachita. Japa. No, not a rule. Okay, what's your instruction?
It's amazing. Maharaj is spoken for over an hour, so it's really, I think it's just, when this video goes out, I think Maharaj, people are going to ask you to speak more in classes, so maybe we can delay the posting. But yeah, thank you so much. It's wonderful to have heard about your book, and then for answering all of our questions. I think many of us know to get this book when it comes out. There are many, Jayadvaita Swami behind the scenes is doing many different projects, and he has a new foundation coming, Krishna Balaram Literary Foundation. Trust.
Now, is it signed now by both parties?
I think the last one's going to be signed this week.
Okay.
We're just contacting the notary.
When Mahaprasad Govinda signs it, then the trust is...
then it will be formal.
So Maharaj wants to protect all of his work in that trust. So if people feel inspired or kind of wanting to do some service and haven't really found something to do, then you can approach today Prajumna Prabhu, Mahaprasad Prabhu, and bounce around some ideas and see if you can get involved in some service for Jayadvaita Swami.